I'm Wallace Ford, and welcome to the Inclusion Show Weekend Edition. At the Inclusion Show Weekend Edition, we try to have conversations with individuals, with our guests, really, whose lives and careers and occupations, professions, vocations are in that place where excellence and passion reside. And we know that when you find an individual who's really very, very good at something, and at the same time, they're passionate about what they do, that we are always going to have a very special conversation. So we're really glad that we have as our guest, Mr. Claude Johnson of the Black Fives Foundation. Claude, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
Okay, really excellent, nice to be here. Excellent. Well, you know, there's so much to talk about, but we want to talk about the Black Fives Foundation, of course, and how you got there. But the Black Fives Foundation, just want our viewers to know, of course, has this exhibit right now, the New York Historical Society. And it's about, of course, the history of Black Americans in basketball, correct?
That's right. It's, well, our foundation, the Black Fives Foundation, I mean, we, as our mission, use the history of pre-NBA, meaning before 1950, the African-American basketball teams and pioneers from before that time frame. We use that to engage youth and others, and we also advocate for the descendants and for the pioneers themselves for better recognition. Mm-hmm. And so one of the, probably the most successful thing we've ever done, I mean, this is incredible, is this exhibition at the New York Historical Society. It's the first ever of its kind, and we're really happy about it.
Well, it sounds great. I mean, you know, we've had Laura Washington, Vice President from the New York Historical Society, on before, talking about just how this fabulous interactive setup that they have at the Historical Society. It makes it a real great experience for young people and not so young people as well coming through. And I want to talk more about that, Claude, but we have to start with the Claude Johnson story in the first place. As we were talking off camera, it said, well, you know, the first question I just want to ask you, well, who the heck is Claude Johnson anyway, and how the heck did you wind up doing this?
That's a question that everybody should wake up and look in the mirror and ask themselves every day, right?
Well, yeah, absolutely.
I got involved in the history of African Americans in basketball when I was working at the NBA. Uh-huh. I was the director of international licensing, and this was 1996 when they celebrated the NBA's 50th anniversary. And part of that anniversary, if you recall, they started doing throwbacks like Fort Wayne Pistons and Sheboygan Redskins, all the predecessor teams.
The Sheboygan Redskins. I didn't know about that one.
Yes,
okay, I was with you at Fort Wayne, but you lost me at Sheboygan.
The Rochester Royals, yeah. The Philadelphia Spurs. All these teams eventually became NBA franchises in some form or another, either short-lived or for longer. Part of that celebration, they published a book called The NBA Encyclopedia of Basketball, which was an 800-page book, but it only had 3 pages in it devoted to the black teams that played prior to the NBA. And I was curious, I liked history, and I had read a book by Arthur Ashe, the tennis great, who is called The Hard Road to Glory, the journey of the African-American athlete, going back to 1600s all the way to the present. And in that book, in the basketball section, he mentioned this team called the Smart Set Athletic Club of Brooklyn.
Uh-huh.
As well as other teams.
Many other teams, right?
Many other teams. Yeah. But I was living in Brooklyn at the time, so that name caught my eye because I was saying to myself, I'm smart, I'm athletic, I live in Brooklyn, I'm in licensing, what's missing? Maybe we should get a t-shirt.
Uh-huh.
Because imagine walking down Flatbush or anywhere in the late 90s or mid-90s with a t-shirt that said Smart Set Athletic Club, established 1904, all black. Who ever heard of such a thing?
So did you actually do the t-shirt?
Well, eventually we did the t-shirt.
Is that right? Okay.
But that really started a whole process of me doing research because the NBA archivist and historian didn't know anything about these teams.
Amazing. I mean, they just didn't know anything about it at all.
The Hall of Fame didn't know anything about this.
That's shameful.
Lobby of Congress and others. And so I eventually...
Did you check with us, how about the Smithsonian?
Smithsonian didn't know.
Amazing.
And so what I discovered, which was very interesting, because I didn't know anything about how to do research, even at the time. I was just really some guy that had an interest in this area. And I found out that you have to go to the library. I mean, it sounds really simple, but...
Still, even in this era of the internet and what have you, you still need to go to archives and actually physically see some of these things.
Physically see stuff. But back then, I mean, your viewers may not all realize that in the 90s even, they didn't have internet, really, right? I mean, you and I know this, but everybody.
Well, I guess the 90s. '90s was still. Yes.
I mean, you had internet. You had email.
But it was limited. It was limited. Yeah.
That's right. And yeah. So I found out that you had to go into the basement, for example, of the Schomburg Library, Schomburg Center for
in Harlem. Yeah.
Yes. Uh-huh. Cultural affairs, and I went there, and they have microfilm readers, and you go through the African American newspapers of the time, the Negro Press, going back to the turn of the century, and I found out that in all of these newspapers, there were weekly write-ups of black basketball, starting as early as the 1900s, 1906, 1907, and I began to compile and document all this history and write up what I found, try to do photocopies of the relevant pages and.
So were you publishing this research, or were you just doing this for your personal edification? Did you share it with anybody at the time?
I wasn't really sharing it. I compiled it all because I wanted to find out more. I knew that there was this just the tip of the iceberg, and that somehow we could find out more. And so so I began that journey, at the time.
Well, that's fantastic because someplace along the line, though, then you decided that you were actually going to do something more than just this personal research, but really turn it into, if it's not a life mission that you're on, it's something pretty damn close to it at this point, huh?
Yeah, well, so somewhere along the way, I realized that these names of these teams just were fascinating and that I felt that there was some kind of commercial opportunity there eventually. The Smart Set Athletic Club, the Independent Pleasure Club of Orange, New Jersey.
The Independent Pleasure Club. What should hold that? Because we're going to come back in just a few minutes. We have a commercial break coming up, I think is the term that's used. But this is fascinating, Claude Johnson, and I want to thank you so much. And we'll be back in just a few minutes. Welcome back to the Inclusion Show Weekend Edition. Our guest is Mr. Claude Johnson, the founder and executive director of the Black Fives Foundation. And Claude, we've been having just a fantastic conversation about just this whole business of the Black Fives Foundation and how it came about. Now, of course, you're doing this research and gathering all this information regarding the history of Black Americans in basketball here in the United States. And we were talking before about this, and it seemed to me when I was reading up in preparation for you coming on the show that the experience of Black people in basketball mirrors, perhaps not perfectly, but certainly mirrors the experience of Black people in baseball. And what do you think about it? I mean, you're the historian on these issues. What do you think? Are we on the right track there?
Yeah, I mean, certainly all of Black culture, Black society was on a parallel course where we were struggling for identity, our own identity, and we were trying to figure out what ways to express that and also to realize and reinforce that in whatever way possible. Music, sports, politics.
That's a very good point. That's a very good point, yeah.
And but specifically in basketball and baseball, they were both opportunities for people to make a living. Mm-hmm. But there's a difference in the fact that baseball is older, and baseball and Major League Baseball, specifically with the Negro Leagues, coincided and lived in parallel back into the 1800s.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But with basketball was a very new sport, invented in 1891. And Blacks didn't really get into basketball until 1904. And even then, for decades afterwards, basketball was struggling just as a sport to find its own place.
Yeah, I mean, just the general, the national basketball, so the NBA really didn't become a big-time sport until well, what did you say, into the 50s, 60s,
that's right.
Really.
Even the NBA, which was organized in 1949, struggled at the beginning.
Absolutely.
For several years. And ironically, the team that helped the NBA succeed was the Harlem Globetrotters, because the Globetrotters were so popular and their popularity was because of teams that led the way, paved the way, like the Harlem Wrens, New York Renaissance.
Mm-hmm.
And they were so popular that the NBA and those owners who came, who brought that league together, would book the Globetrotters for doubleheaders.
Sure.
So that people would get attracted to the games.
And the Washington Generals, can't forget them. Right,
right,
so,
exactly.
But listen, you know, just in terms of that parallel business, in baseball, though, we've got Jackie Robinson. We have this iconic person, larger than life, who transformed, many people say, not only baseball, but America, by becoming the first black player to play in so-called Major League Baseball. Do we have a similar Jackie Robinson type person in basketball?
In a way, yes, but really we're talking about a team. We're talking mm-hmm. about the New York Friends.
Well, please explain. Yeah.
And so we talked about how, you know, there was this chaos really in a certain way where every team that was out there was claiming to be world champions. And until 1939, this newspaper, the Chicago Herald American, decided we're going to have a world championship of professional basketball. And settle once and for all who's the real champion. And they did this by inviting the 12 best pro teams to this tournament in Chicago. Two black teams, the Globetrotters and the Wrens.
Okay, now just so viewers understand, the Globetrotters that you're talking about are not the Globetrotters that we think of today, who, you know, they're entertainers.
That's right.
You know, they're clowning around and all that kind of stuff, which is fine. But the Globetrotters that you're talking about, they could play.
They could play. I mean, these Globetrotters can play too, but it's just that their focus after 1950 went towards comedy and entertainment.
Comedy, yeah, yeah.
Whereas back then, it was somewhat both, but also you had to show up. In other words, your clowning got validated by the actual performance, that the results.
Okay.
So when they had this tournament, it turns out that the Wrens, the New York Renaissance, won that inaugural tournament in 1939.
And they beat teams like...
They beat the 10 best white teams.
White teams, right. Were the Celtics
in the bracket?
I think the Celtics were in there, weren't they?
Original Celtics were
yeah.
in there.
Yeah.
But also they beat the Oshkosh All-Stars.
The Oshkosh All-Stars.
They were the champions of the National Basketball League, which was a whites-only league.
Uh-huh.
So by pulling that off, and doing it in not only with class but also, you know, demonstrably. I mean, it wasn't even close. It sent a signal.
But that was 1939. You said, right?
That's right.
But the first African American to play in the NBA was when? When did that?
It was 1950.
1950.
But you have to realize there were two leagues at that point. There was the Basketball Association of America, the BAA, and the National Basketball League, the NBL.
And they
3 years later, in 1942, the National Basketball League integrated with 10 black players.
I see.
And eventually, they dropped those players and reintegrated in 1946, and then dropped them again. And eventually, those two leagues came together and formed the NBA in 1949. And for one season, the NBA was without black players. And then in 1950, they hired the first three black players.
Now, that's an amazing thought, of course, as we watch basketball today. It's an NBA with no black players. But it, you know, I guess as I'm listening to you, Claude, you were explaining why there wasn't an iconic one guy who just kind of carried the day, because, as you said, it's about the teams and how they progressed in all of this. So, you know, again, one of the things we're going to take a break in just a little bit here, but what I'd like to, when we come back, Claude, I would like to be sure that we talk about just your experience in founding and running this the Black Fives Foundation, and particularly of course this New York Historical Society exhibit, which again, as you've already explained, is, and I think the term is really a big deal, right?
Yeah,
So we want to be sure that people know about this. And again, I just keep going back to the thought that, of course, there's a reason why there's no Jackie Robinson of basketball, because there just was a very different kind of experience.
Yeah, okay. And I want to just point out, I mean, without minimizing, there were the first three or four players in the NBA that were pioneers and had to endure those early days.
Okay. All right, well, thank you. We'll be back in just a minute, and this is The Inclusion Show. Welcome back to the Inclusion Show Weekend Edition. Our guest, Claude Johnson, who is the founder and executive director of the Black Fives Foundation. Claude, we were at the break, we were talking about just who some of the real pioneers were in terms of Black Americans who played in what is the NBA at this point. And you mentioned a couple of people that we should know about.
So in 1949, when the league was formed, there were no Black players for one season. But in 1950, the 50-51 season began with this watershed moment when the NBA hired three Black players. The first to sign a contract was Sweetwater Clifton, who was just elected a couple of months ago into the Basketball Hall of Fame. So we really appreciate that.
And he played for the Knicks, right?
That's right, he played for the Knicks. So maybe now they will put his banner up, you know.
They put his jersey up
in the rafters.
They haven't
done that.
My goodness.
By the way, all three of these players I'm mentioning, they should retire all their numbers throughout the league like they did with Jackie Robinson.
Absolutely.
The first player drafted was Chuck Cooper out of Duquesne University by the Boston Celtics. And then the first player to actually play in a game was Earl Lloyd, and he came from West Virginia State University, where they just put up a statue for him a couple of weeks ago in honor of him, and they named a gym after him. So they're all getting their recognition sooner or later.
Yeah, but you mentioned, I mean, how hard could it be to put Sweetwater Clifton's jersey up in the rafters of Madison Square Garden for the Knicks? I mean, how tough can that be?
There must be some glitch or some reason why they haven't been doing it all these years.
Rare that, unfortunately, many of the Black players in all of the sports, their sense of history is somewhat limited. And they kind of think the league began when they got drafted or when they started playing. So, maybe if some of the players started to step up on that, that might make a difference. But let's talk about, in the time we have left, Claude, let's talk about the exhibit at the New York Historical Society. And just how did that come about? And if my son, as I told you, my son's 17, I'm going to take him to the New York Historical Society to see the Black Fives exhibit. What should I tell him?
As soon as he walks in, it's in the Civil Rights Gallery there. It's the oldest museum in New York City.
That's correct.
So it's appropriate for this to be there because it's the first ever. So as soon as anybody walks in, whether they're teens or adults, they're going to be surrounded by this sense of the love that went into not only this exhibition, but also this history. Everyone that was doing this at the time, at first the history of basketball among Blacks started really for camaraderie and for awareness of health concerns and issues and community building. And then eventually it led to a business model. And then eventually there were teams that came out of that were the best of the best, which paved the way for the NBA. So it's a circular journey. And it's not just chronological tidbits. It takes the visitor through the story of exactly how this all went down. And also, towards the back of the exhibition, there's an area where we have all these modern-day throwback items that are a little bit like eye candy, but there's some Nike retros that probably nobody's ever seen. There's some throwback jerseys. There's some shoes in there that were from the 1910s, basketball shoes that are almost shocking to look at.
Are there any smart set T-shirts there?
There aren't those kinds of merchandise. Uh-huh. It's more things that are inspired by the history.
I see.
We have a proclamation from the mayor of New York City that's on display, the actual proclamation that declared that February 10th last year was declared Black Fives Day for the city of New York.
Fantastic.
So those are the kind of things that make people say, wow, this is really for real.
Yeah. Well, that's Claude, as always, wish we had more time, and for certain, there's a very sincere invitation to have you come back on the show to tell us more about what you're doing. You said that the exhibit is maybe going to Pittsburgh soon, and perhaps other places as well. We're going to be putting up the website for your foundation on our show here, but it's www.blackfives.org. That's
right.
FIVES.
Yes.
All right, and we want people to check it out. And I'm sure that the Black Fives exhibit is going to be coming to a town near you sooner than later. And wish you all the best. And really want to just thank you for making this part of history come alive. It's very important work that you're doing, and want to thank you so much for
coming
on the show.
My pleasure.
Appreciate it, man. We are going to talk about From the Heart, and what we're our topic is in living in the land of no. Now, recently, and there's no reason that everybody should definitely know the name of Debo Adegbile, but Debo Adegbile was nominated by President Obama to head up the Civil Rights Division of the United States Department of Justice. He's a former head of the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. He's also a senior counsel on the Senate Judiciary Committee, a graduate of NYU Law School, eminently qualified. How on earth does this gentleman not get his nomination approved by the United States Senate? I'll tell you how. We have a Republican wing of the Senate and the House of Representatives, which has been on a mission to say no to all things Obama ever since President Obama was inaugurated as president in January of 2009. And so what was the fig leaf, what was the gossamer transparent excuse for blocking Mr. Adegbile's nomination? That at one point, as an attorney, he participated in the appeal of the death sentence of a convicted police killer, Abu Jamal, okay? And what we all have to understand is that right now, the Chief Justice of the United States Supreme Court, John Roberts, he did pro bono work on death row in Florida, including legal work for a serial killer. And nobody, certainly none of these Republicans or the spineless Democrats who voted along with him to block Mr. Adegbile's nomination, ever thought about blocking John Roberts' nomination. So what we've got to say is that, are we looking at hypocrisy? Are we looking at a double standard? Or just another illustration of the effort to just say no to all things Obama? And that's From the Heart, and that's all we have to say on the subject. I want to thank you for watching the weekend edition of The Inclusion Show. My name is Wallace Ford. Thanks so much. Be strong and stay great. Okay, take it out.